Hey everyone, thanks for listening to the very first episode of the Papineau podcast with me, Vita Morales. I'm a Montreal-based artist who plays drums, writes songs, and on rare occasions I'll write a stage play. This podcast is the official podcast of my band King Lobster Krew. We play lively music with influences of surf rock, cumbia, alt rock, and other genres. This project was kind of born out of necessity, as in case you didn't know, Quebec is in the midst of a second lockdown, albeit not as restrictive as the first one. But this still, you know, it's not helpful for playing shows, recording, or rehearsing. And this is something that I felt that I could produce reliably, hopefully on a weekly basis. The premise is kind of like that of a book club where every week I'll be talking about a new album that I either find cool or that has influenced the band in some way. It's possible that you'll get more out of this if you've listened to the album beforehand, so I'll be announcing what album I'm going to be talking about before the episode comes out. But if you want to treat this more as a recommendation podcast, then that's cool too. I'm just happy that you're here listening along and keeping up with the band. Without further ado, this week we're going to be talking about Les Megatones, and in particular their debut album Voici Les Megatones. They were a Quebec surf rock band that gained prominence in the Yeah Yeah era. Some would even cite them as pioneers of the movement in Quebec, or at least among the most prolific acts. The Yeah Yeah era, which derives from the English Yeah Yeah, was one in which France, Quebec, and even Spain's pop music was being influenced by a lot of Anglo rock and roll, the Beatles, teen pop tunes, etc. Artists in Quebec, for example, during this time, would even record the hits of the day, but actually just substitute the English lyrics for their own translations, or sometimes not even give it a proper translation in the traditional sense, and just give the song entirely new French lyrics with like a different meaning. Consequently, Yeah Yeah artists produced music that was obviously influenced by the likes of their Anglo contemporaries, but simultaneously injected their own cultural identity into it, just by the very nature of singing in their native languages. If you really want to be cynical about it, I suppose you could say that it started out as a bit of a ripoff, but you can't deny that 60 years down the line, you know, it's kind of become part of Quebec's cultural history. And the same can certainly be said about France and Spain. Les Megatones got their start playing at a recreation center in Quebec City that would host a radio program on the now defunct CHRC by the name of the Youth Cabaret. Their growing popularity eventually led them to record their debut album in 1962, another album in 1963, and another one in 64. They would enjoy touring success in Quebec and the US for the span of a couple of years, but in 1965, much of the Yeah Yeah popularity had waned, and Les Megatones had to change their name to Les Ook Piks in an effort to sort of reinvent themselves. They would release one album in 66 under the new name, but were unable to regain much of their former popularity and disbanded shortly thereafter, only to record once more in 77, once more under the name of Les Megatones. In short, Les Megatones and bandleader Denis Champoux were able to write some very cool music that definitely holds a special place in the national memory of Quebec. Champoux would focus on country until his death in 2017. The reason that I chose this album in particular is because I find the tunes on it are actually quite refreshing as far as surf rock goes. And I don't mean that pejoratively, only that because so much of what makes the style of surf rock what it is, you know, it's timbral, right? So what I think tends to happen is that composition-wise, there's an oversaturation of surf rock tunes that are just 12-bar blues or descending chord progressions, sort of in the style of Hit the Road Jack, even within the same album, right? Because, you know, surf rock is a vibe, so slap on some spring reverb on it and, you know, who cares what the rest of the form, you know, who cares what the form of the tune is, right? But Voici Les Megatones has enough diversity form-wise that it doesn't overstay its welcome. I would think that this sort of like compositional monotony was detrimental to surf rock staying power as time went on. Because, you know, when you think about it, as far as like through and through surf rock shredding, Dick Dale was the one who enjoyed the most career longevity. And yes, Pulp Fiction was certainly a windfall for him to a degree in sort of like having a career revival in the 90s, but even then, he was able to keep it as fresh as he did for as long as he did, because it due in part to his like ability to blend styles together and borrow from things like folk tunes, like in the case of Miserloo. And even in his like career revival in the 90s, his new albums leaned into like a heavier, almost stoner rock vibe, but he did keep his guitar tone a bit reminiscent of the stuff that he did in the 60s. You know, all this to say that keeping things fresh in surf rock certainly goes a long way as far as staying power is concerned. And it would have been easy for Les Megatones to pump out an album that largely all sounds the same, but I think they were really smart in how they included, you know, among other things, surf rock tunes, like surf covers of tunes that were already popular in the 60s, surf arrangements of classical music and their own original tunes as well. I think it's a really cool vibe. I think a really good example of just keeping things novel and fresh and or whatever is the track Funiculi Funicula, because this was written in 1880 originally by Luigi Denza. He wrote it to commemorate the funicular rail line that was built to take people up to the top of Mount Vesuvius. Yes, that Mount Vesuvius. And I'm gonna play like a snippet of like sort of like a straight interpretation of the tune, and then I'll play you a bit of the Megatones version, because the way that the Megatones version sort of like interprets what you could call the head, like if we're going to use a jazz term, I mean, like the melody itself, he like drags out the phrase where it's like more suitable for like a 4/4 rock tempo, whereas the original is a 6/8. It's like very brisk, it's very, anyway, you'll hear it. So yeah, I mean, that's definitely keeping things fresh, in my opinion. It's a cool arrangement, and even the original tunes that have a little more conventional chord progressions or forms, Denis Champoux was smart enough not to drag them out, I think. Rideau, s'il vous plaît, is a 12-bar blues with a cool melody, but it's only a minute and 48. I mean, it's kind of hard to get sick of it in that time. Mega Twist is a 1-6-4-5 progression with a 8-bar melody that repeats almost identically in the A section. It's only at the end of the phrase that it changes before going into a 10-bar B section. And the reason that it's 10 bars instead of like some multiple of 8 is because they add a little turnaround for 2 bars. Another B section that does that is the one from Can't Help Falling in Love. But anyway, I bring this up because even within the tunes that happen to have tried and true compositional techniques, they never overstay their welcome, and they're just a lot of fun. Another tune where they take this where they take classical music and surf it up is their version of the Nutcracker, which I think is cool because I do think that this practice in general of taking a really, really old tune and making it your own should happen more. That's not to say that it doesn't happen at all, but like, you know, like the bebop musicians of the 40s and 50s did this a lot, and it's just entertaining. It's just an entertaining way to show off your soloing abilities and your arranging chops, like regardless of what genre it is. I mean, it, like it can be cheesy if it's not done well. And I do think that there's like an overabundance of maybe punk covers of tunes. I mean, is that just me or like, is that genre like overrepresented when it comes to things like this? I don't know. Previously, I gave a very Spark Notes version of the history of this band, and I'm going to add to that and just say that this album, which came out in 1962, was kind of the result of their being discovered by Yvan Dufresne, who saw them on a gig and afforded them the opportunity to record at Apex Records and record a full-length LP off the bat as opposed to something like singles, presumably because he saw that people were receptive to the music. They would record at Apex in 63 and 64 for both their albums that they released in those years as well. They would tour in 63 in Quebec and 64 in the US. And yeah, they're kind of like hometown heroes for those that remember them. All in all, they enjoyed some decent popularity at their peak. The personnel on, let me check out the liner notes. Personnel was Ralph Angelillo on drums, Denis Champoux on guitar, and I think wrote most of the compositions for this first album, Claude Patry on guitar, and Jean Poirier on bass. At some point, Patrick Roy's dad, the hockey player, Patrick Roy, also played in this band, but I couldn't find exact dates for when he was doing that. But yeah, cool band, cool little nugget of or cool little part of history. And yeah, so if you want to keep up with King Lobster Krew, this is part of what we're going to be doing in terms of regular content. So if you got something out of this, if you enjoyed this recommendation, tune in next time. I'll give you another one. Yeah, peace.